threatening to sue me, so...
Threatening to sue you?
Oh, yeah.
Even though you claim that she pushed you first?
Absolutely.
And you have witnesses to that effect?
Oh, yes.
I see. Well, it's an interesting case, Robin.
I don't think we've gotten to the bottom. Did you rule?
I could rule, but wouldn't it be unfair unless I hear Shannon's side of the story?
Oh,
well, screw Shannon. She isn't calling
in. Yeah, she wants to call in. You can change her.
I rule in favor of Bo Money. Because Bo Money, number one, was very honest about her relationship with a week of Eddie Murphy.
Oh, wrong. Listen to you, Howard.
You said you were with Eddie for
what? What does that have to do with the case?
Nothing, but I like your honesty. Yeah. I found you to be honest. I also found that there was a little bit of resentment on your part towards celebrities.
Why?
Because if you rewind the tape, you'll hear yourself saying, yes, it got you a little irritated that she was getting so much attention.
But
I must tell you that I do find your story somewhat interesting and compelling, and based on the facts that you've given me, I find you innocent.
Oh, well, great, thank you.
And I award you two more nights with Eddie.
No, you know what, that's okay.
And you've had TV stars as well, huh?
Well, you know,
well, you must be quite a good looker. Why don't you send me a picture of yourself so I can take a look at you?
You don't have one yet, Howard?
Nope.
I'm shocked.
How come I don't have one, Robin?
I don't know where her pictures are, Howard.
You haven't seen Howard Cappy?
No, I have not. Have you been on there?
I've been on everything.
No, I have not seen that, Bo Money.
You should check it out, Howard.
All right. Well, obviously you're using this to parlay it into some kind of press and trying to get some attention for your career. Am I correct? See, there could have been a motive here.
No, there was no motive.
I might be establishing motive here, Robin.
Wait,
she might have said she
might
have been...
It's a publicity stunt?
Might be a publicity stunt.
Oh, you think it was planned?
Well, I didn't say I think that. I'm saying that I'm establishing motive.
Oh, no, it wasn't at all.
When did you realize it was Shannon Doherty? Maybe we need to reopen the case.
Hold it, Robin. Don't answer the question like that. This is how you have to ask it. When did you realize it was Shannon Doherty in that club? At what point in the night did you realize that?
After I grabbed her.
When you were in a drunken rage?
After I grabbed her.
After you grabbed her, you realized
she
was.
She was in a drunken rage.
Oh, no, but what about you? Two drinks.
Oh, two drinks. That's
it's right. And grapefruit juice.
That's lightweight, Howard.
So you followed her to the club, didn't you?
No.
So you admit it?
No, definitely not.
Now, you say you didn't realize it was Shannon until after you pushed her?
Right.
I doubt that.
Seriously?
Really?
We had just got there.
Hey, you want to play Dial-A-Date next Friday?
Dial-A-Date?
Yeah.
What's that?
Will some guys get to go out with you? When are you coming to New York?
The 15th.
What is the 15th?
Tuesday.
This Tuesday?
No, it's next Tuesday.
Next Tuesday.
Want to play Dial-A-Date? I'll set you up with one of the guys here for a date that night.
What guys?
Yeah, one of the guys in my audience.
Oh, they have to be, like, really hot for me to go out with them.
Yeah, well, they are.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
They'll tell you how hot
they are. They'll tell you how hot they are. Why, you're so hot that your husband was didn't even have any money. What are you talking about? Was he so hot?
Well, he was hot. May not have money, but he was hot.
Well, you want to play or not?
Yeah, let's play.
All right. Well, we'll get you in here,
but
Tuesday.
You have to pre-screen him, Howard.
Yeah,
sure
I'll screen
hot.
Him. I'll screen him and make sure they're hot. We'll fix him. I know this guy's a limo driver. He's really good looking.
Oh, wrong.
No, I mean, that's his job, but he's considered like the sexiest guy. This guy, Ronnie, he's like the sexiest guy in New York.
Oh, right.
Yeah, he won Mr. Sexy Legs contest.
Oh, please. Sexy Legs.
No, I'll get you a good guy.
I hope so.
I want to see how hot you are.
Oh, well, check out People magazine.
You got that, Robin?
I don't have it here with me. You were in People?
Next Friday.
Oh, next week.
What are you wearing in there, mini pants?
Oh, it's too hot, Howard. Wait till you see it.
All right. Well, very good. Okay. Well, obviously, this has not been a bad thing for you, has it?
No, it's actually been pretty good.
Will you be arguing with other celebrities to get more than People magazine?
When can we see you fight again?
When's your next bout?
I don't know.
Will you go to the Roxbury and hope to meet other celebrities that you can get in a fight with?
Oh, I don't look to fight, Howard.
And whose foot will you be stepping on tonight?
No one tonight.
All right, well, you come in here next Tuesday. I'll put you on hold. Gary will talk to you.
All righty, babe.
And I'll get you on Dial-A-Date.
All right.
I'll set you up with a guy.
All righty.
Since you're a grieving widow.
Thanks, Alex.
All right, hold on. You know what you ought to do?
What?
You ought to go to a Lakers game and puke on somebody. I bet you get in. What do you call it? A movie.
Hey, good idea.
All right, hold on. I'm telling you, all she had to do was push down Shannon Doherty. She's in People.
Yeah.
If she vomits on someone at a Lakers game like Jack Nicholson.
She could be in a movie, you're right.
Be in a movie, I'll get her own TV series. People Magazine. Isn't that great? You get into a shoving match and they put you in. I love it.
It just doesn't matter what you do these days. You get to be a celebrity.
Makes me insane. Well, how do you like that, Robin? That was quite an interview.
Yeah, I think we uncovered a lot.
Tell you, all that girl has to do is go out and fart in Mike Ovitz's face while in his studio. Oh, are you Mike Ovitz? Mm. All right, here's your key. Wait a second, the National Enquirer needs to speak with you. See what happens, Robin? A lot of people get famous just for getting in a shoving match.
Yeah, some people work hard to get recognition, and other people just come along and push them, and well, they get to be famous, too.
Well, if Bo Money is telling the truth, it seems to me that she was innocent.
Well, come on, Howard. Let's be serious. If, as she says, some inebriated person came over out of control and started an argument, this is the worst thing you can do is argue with them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're just spoiling for a fight. What are you doing? You're supposed to be the sane one in the situation.
Yes. Well, who knows? So, in other words, what you're saying is we don't know until we hear both sides of the story. And how would you like to be the judge who has to sit down with these two yentas while they sit there and scream at each other? Like there's an answer to any of that.
I mean, drunks have yelled at me before. I've never pushed them or never done anything. I don't wind up in the paper.
But you admit to chasing homosexuals.
I did do that. Yes.
Right.
But I was very young, and I should not be treated as an adult in that case.
They both sound like two girls who are really good-looking, who have lots of money, and they're two spoiled brats,
right,
quite frankly.
Yes.
I mean, you know, I mean, like, what are you doing? Life is perfect. What do you got to go out and create?
You're
tension?
Out on a Tuesday night. Nothing I can do.
Nothing that we've ever done. We've never been able to go out on a Tuesday night.
I'm pissed just for that. I want to push both of them.
I think they're bored. But, okay, let the judge decide. Meanwhile, we'll get her on dial a date. She sounds like a hot little find.
Yeah.
I'm sure one of you dudes in the audience could tame her. Taming of the shrew. That's all. Set you up on a date. Well, they better be hot.
Yes,
all right.
It's been a week with Eddie Murphy. Is he hot?
He's not hot. That's right. Want to get out of here?
Yeah, let's do it.
Did you have enough? Want to do some plugs? All right, let me do a final plug at 1-800-52-STERN. Let me just briefly say that we've gotten so many faxes, Robin. Let me read you a letter I received.
Okay.
Dear Howard, Robin, and crew. That would be Jackie and Fred. And Gary. Just received your video in one word. Excellent. Every scene was absolutely funny. The 3D was the best I've ever seen. Jessica has a perfect body, and the KKK guy was a scream. But let's face facts. The lesbians were the best. When that blonde was telling the story of how another girl was working on her, man, was that hot. And they were okay looking, too. The night we received the video, we were excited to watch it. We had to exercise first. So while my wife was changing, I looked at her naked buttocks and played butt bongo with her.
Ah.
Even before we exercised or watched the tape, we figured, let's play a little butt bongo. And then watch you play it. And guess what? It was the same. I strongly suggest this tape for couples. Howard, we feel you have started something great. At least everybody should give butt bongo a try. And I guess if you really don't know how to work your wife into it, make her watch the tape. You know
yeah,
what I mean?
There you go. That will be your entree.
Any guy who does not buy this and show his girl is a total jerk. Who knows? The lesbians make it look so good. Maybe our girlfriends and wives would like to try that too. Howard, we're big fans and we've purchased everything you put out. This is really excellent work. And he says the funniest shot in the whole video was the camera pan to the little baby doll with the big glasses and hair. Very funny. And anyone who's seen it knows what he's talking about in the 3D sketch. Well, there's a lot here, and if you're any fan of the show, you should really have this tape. And you know what else, Robin?
What?
Point is that this is just really good work. And it makes an excellent Christmas gift. And let's face it, this will become a collector's item. So if you're thinking, hey, maybe I'll get this in a year or two, you won't be able to. This is a one-of-a-kind purchase.
That's right. Don't just laze around thinking it'll always be available. It won't.
Right. It won't be. And there's only two more days left. We've added on 2 days, today and tomorrow. If you want to get this
before Christmas.
That's right. 1-800-52-STERN, $34.95. Have your credit card out when you order, and please do it today. You must be 18 or older, and it's brought to you by Infinity Ventures and me. Jogi the Jackman.
Wait a minute. Let me just tell you that ABC executives were so concerned about the performance of the Jackie Thomas show, the new Tom Arnold show that they premiered last week, that they commissioned a special minute-by-minute ratings report on the show's premiere episode last week.
Yes. And what did they find?
I'm trying to see. I just found this.
A minute-by-minute ratings report. I mean, any given minute they can tell who's watching it?
Yeah. They wanted to see if people would stick with the program for its entire half hour on the air.
Well,
the results were encouraging for the network. Most viewers stayed with the show from start to finish.
Right.
A sign that for at least one entire episode, they were not bothered by the abrasiveness of Tom Arnold's character.
Well, if you notice, they kept Tom Arnold mostly out of the show.
That's what I say. I mean, and they're crediting Tom with being smart enough not to put him in it too much.
Yeah. He's god-awful. It's really the Buffalo Bill show with Tom Arnold. And it's like, why?
Buffalo Bill didn't work.
Right. Yoko.
And that was good.
You had to see Tom Arnold on Saturday Night Live. It's painful. It's painful.
Well, they say that the first episode of Jackie Thomas had the smallest fall off from Roseanne of any show that has ever been in that time period. But that was one episode.
Yeah. We're hoping
if they come back this week.
We're hoping the rest of America will wake up.
Yeah.
Jackie Penhouse Joke Page Martling this Saturday, December 12th, one big show at Club Binet in Sayreville, New Jersey. Go try and stump the joke, man. For show information and endless dirty jokes, call the All Digital 516-922-WINE. Remember, 922-WINE is just the regular call. Boy Gary this Saturday at Collector's Palace Animation Gallery in Manhattan from 5 to 7 p.m. hosting an evening with Warner Brothers animator Virgil Ross. Gary actually hanging out with animators.
Boy.
My goodness, he's really insinuated himself.
Yeah. And he's also gotten next to these guys. Stuttering John will be hosting a beauty contest at Spanky's, an adult nightclub in West Orange, New Jersey. I know you're going to that, Robin. Wednesday night, December 9th. John will be at Cadillac Jack's in Orangeburg, New York, Friday night, December 11th, and at the Royal Pub in Roselle, New Jersey, Saturday night, December 12th, signing pictures.
I just wonder if there's any significance to the name Spanky's.
Yeah. Well, those are the good gigs. John gets all the good ones. Meet Captain Jenks Tuesday night.
Oh, dear.
Well, he's doing something for charity, so I should get him a plug. At the YSP Marathon for Meals in the parking lot. Jenks will be in a parking lot at the Adams Mark Hotel on City Line Avenue.
Well, this is appropriate.
Captain Jenks. How did he get that? How did he manage that?
He would have been there anyway.
Right. I think he's just announcing where he's going to be. Not that he's going to be there for anyone. Join Scott the Engineer every Friday for Classic 70s Disco Night at the Country Club, 209 East 85th Street. If you need a mobile DJ for your wedding or Christmas party, call Rocket Entertainment from anywhere, 718-BAG-5040, a member of the American Disc Jockey Association.
One more?
This just in. Tonight, Fred Norris appearing in Foreplay.
Oh, yes.
Everyone's going tonight to see him. I understand Gary, Jackie, and Ganji.
John.
And John.
Yes. And Dan, I think there's more than 20 of us going.
There's a whole gang going to see Fred Norris act
gaggle.
Tonight.
Gaggle.
You guys going to heckle Fred?
No.
Come on, go for it.
Go for it.
Say, hey, Fred, what are you doing?
I'm expecting it, actually.
Hey, that's not Bob. That's Fred.
Fred. He never teases us.
No. Tonight, Fred Norris appearing in Foreplay, one of four one-act plays. Fred Norris, the actor.
Yes, don't see Fred Norris, the guy who's here.
Right.
It's not
Fred.
The King of Mars. No. This is the actor.
Do Kurt, Fred.
Why don't you ever do these on a Saturday night where I could go? Robin and I would like to.
Yeah,
see.
Well,
this
I'd
is
like
the only time.
Robin and I are the only ones who take our job seriously.
This is true.
Everybody else goes out during the week. God forbid we start doing that.
Really? Let's go see Fred tonight. See how we do tomorrow.
Yeah.
You know.
Tonight, Fred Norris. I'm sorry, Gary. Yes.
No, I was going to mention something. You're talking about Captain Jenks' appearances and stuff.
Yeah.
I did one down in Philadelphia over the Thanksgiving weekend.
Yes.
And when I got there, Captain Jenks was there, and I shook his hand and said hello to him. And before I knew it, he had pulled up a chair next to me and was just signing over my face.
He was signing your picture.
Yeah. People would like get in line, and I would sign a picture, and then they would go down the line, and they didn't know who he was, and he would just grab it and sign, you know, Captain Jenks.
I mean, even if you don't want a Captain Jenks autograph,
exactly.
You get it. Oh, my is right. Show business hell.
But he didn't get paid for that. He just does it for the glory.
Oh, yeah.
Well, that's all Jenks ever wants, glory.
No, glory. He just wants to fool one girl into thinking that he's a celebrity. Tonight, Fred Norris appearing in Foreplay, one of four one-act plays by Frederick Stroppel at Village Theater, 133 West 22nd. Fred only appears in dramatic plays.
Yes, he's not a comedian.
Right.
He is strictly drama.
At 7:30 every Monday, it's Fred Norris night.
Actually, the last two performances, this one and next week. And
is
that's
that
it.
Right?
That is it.
And then you're done.
And we're
Freddie
off the
will
stage.
Not extend.
You will not extend if they ask.
You will not extend.
Because your schedule does not permit.
That is it. It will
I
not.
See.
Too many conflicts.
I see.
Unless everybody calls the cable.
Yeah.
And shall we say that the Larry Sanders Show
yeah.
will be on HBO every night this week.
Is that right?
Gary Shandling's show, yes.
That is a good show.
They will be showing all the episodes for the next 2 weeks, every night at 11 o'clock on HBO.
Is that right?
Yes. I thought we ought to give Gary a plug since he did your first E! Show.
Yeah. There you go. Not that he deserved it.
Well, I just, you know, hey, I'm being magnanimous.
Gary Shandling tells me now I owe him because he came on my show.
That's, you just paid him back.
Yeah. There's, thank you. There's your payback.
There
dude.
You go.
There you go. What is it?
Actually, I heard that the word on him is that Gary Shandling is really shy and sort of weirded out for doing stuff, so everyone was really surprised when he agreed to do your show.
Yeah, but meanwhile, I saw him on the Ben Stiller show last night.
And he's
night.
On the Tonight Show tonight. I mean, he's everywhere.
He's not shy.
Except for those shows.
Yeah.
Shy.
He's on every show. I thought it was something special he came on my show. Now I see him on the Ben Stiller show.
Actually, he said that guy who was with him during your taping was from the Ben Stiller show.
He probably said, hey, if you're doing Stern, you can do it.
Yeah, really. He was standing there just to usher him over.
Yeah. All right. Anything else, Robin?
That's it.
That's it? Okay. Fred, any more plugs?
No more plugs.
All right. That's the only thing you're appearing
No more appearances?
No more.
Fred, what is your next acting project? Seriously, what will you tackle next?
Well, it depends what they send me.
Right. You know, every actor figures that every job is his last one, Fred. Do you feel that way?
It probably is my last
one. Are you mulling over scripts now, seriously?
No one is sending me any, so we're not doing
but
anything.
But you are willing to read.
I'm willing to entertain any.
Right. Maybe we'll go with Gary Shandling on his... Shandling, by the way, will be sitting in with Jimmy Fink on Saturday.
Is that right?
Yeah, right. Real shy. Mr. Shy will be sitting in with Jimmy Fink. All right, Robin, I'll see you tomorrow.
Okay.
This is Paul McCartney on 92.3 K-Rock, and you're listening to New York's Groovier Station.
92.3 K-Rock is proud to be the station that...
It was a beautiful day, sun beat down, and the radio wall, I was driving. Trees went by, me and Del were singing. Anything was possible. It was control. But my eyes. The last 3 days, the rain was unstoppable. It was always cold. No sunshine. Right.
good.
And to this day in Poland, they do say, hey, we don't, you know, we love the Jews in Poland, but there's only two left. Poles are very...
3 million. They left the half there.
That's why a lot of Jews, I don't think, care if Poland's free or not. I think you just see this basic animosity between Jews and Poles. I saw it growing up a lot of the Poles like to get in fights with Jews. Seems to be like a natural thing.
Why is that?
I don't know. Let's hear from some Poles. If you're Polish and you hate Jews, can you give us a call? We'd like to discuss it with you.
Well, Valenza was apologizing. He just said, I'm sorry. Okay?
Okay. I mean, what do you want me to do? That's like when I argue with my mother. How many times do I have to say I'm sorry before she finally, like, you know, lets it go? Let it go.
So he was begging forgiveness because they really are looking for business over there.
I see.
In Poland.
Oh. And you're not going to have any business without Jews. Poland was actually doing pretty good when they had Jews. They had a pretty thriving economy.
Yeah?
But then they killed them all and...
Look what happened.
Howard.
Yeah. Are you Polish?
No, man.
Oh, too bad.
I want to tell you how to take Letterman off.
Take what?
Take Letterman off.
Take Letterman off?
Yeah.
Why? Let me ask you something. No offense with your... you're not an agent, are you?
No, but...
Why would I want to take someone off who has been good to me and, you know...
He stole your shtick, man.
He didn't steal my... Well...
Well, he did, man.
Yeah, but you don't...
Go on the show.
All right, you're sidetracking me, dude.
No.
I'm into the Polish-Jew thing, okay?
Hey, I've been holding off while I go over now.
I gotta just get to this Polish thing, though.
I can't get on.
Oh, I think he wanted to get on. I got you. Hey, you Polish?
We can't find a Polish person.
You Polish? How come you can find him if you're in Poland? Calling all Polaks. Calling all Polaks. Polaks and Jews, call us. Where is everyone who's Polish, Robin? You know.
They're in Israel.
You Polish?
Trying to make friends.
With Lech Walesa.
What's happening, Alex?
You Polish?
Yeah.
Oh, good. So how can you hate Jews?
No, I don't.
Oh. Yeah,
I have a couple Polacks that work for me, though.
Oh, you're not Polish.
Real attitude.
Oh, you're not Polish?
I am.
Oh, you are?
Yeah.
What?
But I mean, I was born here and everything.
But you have some people who live... Who are from the old country working for you. Is that what you're saying?
There's no way you're Polish and you don't hate Jews. There's just no way.
No, that's
just,
not true.
It's kind of a thing.
No, I'm a contractor right now, and the Jewish people are my biggest customers.
Oh, really? Oh. Smart, you're a smart Polish guy.
Yeah.
All right, hey, dude, I got to go.
Take care.
I'm not looking for a guy who likes Jews.
Hmm.
This doesn't serve our purpose right now. Hey, who's in the Letterman with me tonight, Robin?
Oh, let's take a look.
Open up that paper for a second, will you? I can't find any Polacks.
The world is devoid.
Everyone's widows. No one's proud to be Polish anymore. What, New York does? I know New York has tons of Poles. New York is Jews, blacks, and Poles.
Is that it? No
Italians?
Italians.
What is this? Where is everybody?
Come forward and speak to us.
Well, Philly's got tons of Poles.
But you can't find any.
Can't find any.
Well, that's ruining this bit.
Yeah. We could call over to let him and find out who's on.
Well, I usually have my little lineup of the talk shows here. Of course, I can't find it now. I'm just looking at it, too.
Imagine in New York announcing you want to talk to Poles. You know what New York is? New York is Jews, blacks, Italians, and then more Jews. Right? Too many Jews.
Well, that's what everyone seems to think who doesn't live here.
Yeah. You go a couple of blocks, you see some Jews, then you see some blacks, then you see some Italians, and then you see tons more Jews. Tons of them. They're everywhere, those Jews.
It's gotten to the point where if you're white, you must be Jewish.
Right. And if you're not, you're marrying one. Right, Fred?
Absolutely.
Somehow.
You're on the air.
Is this Howard Stern?
Yes, it is.
Yeah, I'm Polish.
All right. Now, when did you start hating Jews? Like, right away?
Man, no, you get taught
that? A lot of people piss me off. A lot of Jewish people piss me off.
All right, okay, that's legitimate. It's good to air your beliefs.
Huh?
It's good to air your feelings.
Right.
Maybe we can get through this.
All right.
All right, now what happens? When do they start pissing you off?
I don't know. I just think, my father hates Jews. He's very Polish.
Right.
He's very Polish.
He's talking about all the economic problems they cause in the country.
Right.
They cause economic problems?
You know, a lot of the underground, they keep all the money and they don't share it with anybody.
Right. So your father's basically is from Poland, right? He's like, he came to this country?
Yeah, him and all his parents.
Right.
him and his parents and brothers and sisters, they all came from Poland.
So they were able to get rid of all the Jews in Poland, but that didn't solve the economic problems when they got rid of all the Jews. It made it worse.
Yeah, but they came over here and caused all the problems over here.
Oh, but wait a second. Here's the logic I don't get, though.
All right.
The idea of getting rid of all the Jews in Poland was to make the economy better. But the economy got worse when they got rid of all the Jews.
The economy did not get worse. The economy got better.
I'm talking about in Poland.
The economy is fine in Poland.
What, are you kidding me?
Now?
It's fine.
What? What are you talking about?
The economy in Poland is fine. That's not the problem over there.
Oh, what's the problem?
See, when Germany got rid of all their Jews, the economy prospered. Now they're like one of the richest nations in the world.
Yeah. What happened in Poland?
What?
What happened in Poland?
Poland, the economy is fine.
Oh. So you think all the Jews came over to the United States and ruined the economy here, but the economy's pretty good here.
The economy's terrible here.
Well, right now
we're
it is.
We're in a recession, and we owe everybody, we owe Israel tons of money, we owe everybody tons
we
of money.
We owe Israel money.
Oh, boy. See what I mean? I told you this is a basic thing between Poles and Jews.
Did you hear, do you know what the debt is over here?
Yeah.
You know why?
What? Why?
Jewish people.
Oh, come on.
See?
See? Well, I told you there's a basic problem. Nobody believes me, but at least this guy's being honest.
Yeah, I mean, that's the way I believe, you know?
I know, I got you.
I think
I hear you.
They own all the major industries here. They own the movie industry, they own the business market,
yeah.
And they keep the money within themselves.
They don't share.
They don't share the money.
They don't share it.
The world is doomed.
It is.
It really is.
Jewish people run America, and Japanese are buying it.
See, only the Japanese either.
How come the Jews are selling to the Japanese?
Then why are the Jews selling to the Japanese? I thought they keep everything to themselves.
Huh?
That's one thing I can't figure out.
Who, Jews?
Yeah, I'm following all your logic, but why are the Jews selling out of the Japanese? I thought they'd like to keep the money to themselves.
Well, the Jews, what's left of America, the Japanese is buying. They're just smarter than the Jews, that's all.
Oh, they outsmarted them.
I don't think the Jews particularly like them, but they're just the Japanese are just too smart for them.
Now, how come the Jews keep outsmarting all the Poles?
Excuse me?
How do the Jews keep outsmarting all the Poles?
Oh, there's not enough Poles in America to substantiate anything.
Oh.
So if there were more. Yeah,
if there were more.
Once they got the money, they're not giving it up, and they're not going to let anybody else in. I mean, look at all the movie industry.
Right.
All the producers are, you know.
You never see any Polish films.
Everybody.
You never do. You never see any Polish films.
That
guy's got a point.
Right. You see a few Italians, some French. All the big producers are Jewish.
It's very rare you see a Polish film.
No, you never see a Polish film.
The Polish film industry is all but dead.
Yeah, I mean, artistically, Poland is, you know, dance. Nothing.
All right. Okay. There's nothing I'm going to do to help him work this out.
His father got to him first.
Right. Although, did you ever see that movie Home Alone-ski that they sent over from Poland? It was like sort of like a rip-off of Home Alone. And it wasn't bad. It really wasn't. You didn't see it?
Sorrow and the Pity is probably the biggest German film.
Yeah. All right, dude.
Hey, thanks for talking to me, man.
Okay, man. All right, bye.
Bye-bye.
Want to see Madonna?
So I guess he's not asking for forgiveness. Unlike Lech Walesa, who went to Israel.
You know, I can't... The only film I ever saw in Poland, you know, of Poland, that somebody made in Poland.
Yeah.
Was when I was in college. Dances with Girls. You ever see that?
Dances with Girls.
It was pretty good.
Stop it.
It was a precursor to... Is there such a thing as a precursor?
Yes.
Right. What is it, man?
All right, who would you rather talk to? A woman who has no idea who you are, who wants to defend the Jews, or a Polish guy with a thick Polish accent?
I think, why don't we get them both on the air?
Let them talk to each other.
Talk to each other.
Oh, hi.
Can you line that up?
Yeah.
Okay. I say let everyone on.
A woman who wants to defend the Jews? Well, we weren't attacking.
I didn't attack the Jews. All right. See, Gary's got one on hold. That could be either our Polish guy with a thick accent or our Jewish woman.
Baba Booey.
Baba Booey out there producing like a madman.
Baba Booey.
And now, for your listening pleasure, let's meet some Jews and Poles. Mike, Give it a chance, Robin.
Okay.
You're a little too anxious over there. I see you over there. You're looking.
On the edge of my seat.
Who's on Letterman with me tonight? Do you know?
I can't find this out. The only person they say is you.
Maybe some Poles and Jews. Well, we can call over there. We'll find out.
They like everyone, but...
Hello? Hello?
Hello? Hello?
Yes?
Is this Howard?
No, this is Andre.
Andre. Well, I'm waiting to speak to Howard.
Me too. I think they put us together.
Oh.
Are you Polish?
Yes.
Oh. Tym razem czekamy, żeby rozmawiać z Howardem.
Excuse me?
You know what this is like when Harry Ski met Sally Ski? Isn't it? Like I put these two together?
Yeah. But my last name isn't has a ski in it. It's just, my grandmother came from Poland. She came over with nothing and worked her little butt off, and that's why... You know, all the Jews do that. They work their butts off so they can get what they get.
Nothing wrong with that.
So this guy can't say that. We own everything. We might, because we do work very hard. He doesn't.
Sir, you want to rebut that?
Well, I could say about that, you know, that's true that lots of Polish people don't like Jews, but that's different reason for that. That is a little bit jealousy, but what I would like to say is, your statement about that Polish people killed 3.5 million Jewish people, you're forgetting about Germans. We were on the same side as Jewish people. We were attacked by Germans. And you must know that Poland, it wasn't a bad country for Jewish people. There was the biggest population of Jews in Europe in Poland. When they were pushed...
All right, listen. Let's look. Listen, you two geniuses.
Listen to me.
Listen to me. I'll tell you how the world is. Poles don't like Jews.
That's true.
The Jews don't like the Poles. It's a natural animosity. There's too much bad blood went down. A lot of Poles killed a lot of Jews. And a lot of Jews resent them for it. And who knows? Who knows what went on?
No.
Ah, come on. Get with it.
Tell you the truth. I don't think... A lot of the Polish people are Jews in New York.
It's time to forget. Maybe we can get past this. Maybe you two can hook up and talk about it.
No, I doubt it. I really do.
Listen, why did everybody there? Because this was most tolerant place in the Europe.
All right. Hey, you two want to go see Madonna?
Do I want to see Madonna?
From everywhere else, they went to Poland.
Does this guy ever shut up or what?
No. He's nanny and the professor. He's a history professor.
I think you should get some degree, maybe.
Captain Gilbas is on the phone here.
Howard, I want to thank you for listening to me.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, hey, if, whatever. Okay, thank you, too.
Bye.
It's a Jewish...
Wait a minute, they wanted the Madonna tickets?
Yeah, you want the Madonna tickets? Pick up! Give them away tomorrow. I like that guy. He was cool. She was good, too.
Yeah.
They were both good. I like that.
Yep, the only thing I can find in the paper is that you're on David Letterman tonight. I don't know who else is on.
I love how people are phony. I mean, everyone knows Poles hate Jews. Who doesn't know that?
Well, that was their big excuse. Well, it was the Germans. The Germans made us do it.
But listen, it's a fact of history. Poles don't like Jews. So if I was a Jew, I'd get the hell out of Poland.
Sure, we had these big gas chambers, and the Jews got in them, and they burned up. But the Germans...
I'm not surprised that Lech Walesa's over there begging Israelis. Those are guys who are going to have a hard time forgetting what went down. I mean, they're so into it that they moved into the middle of a desert to get away from people. I mean, you know, who's going to argue that? There's always some people arguing this stuff. Sometimes you got to just accept facts. I accept things. There's a natural hatred there.
Yeah, but everybody wants to make an excuse. You know, it's like, but wait a minute.
Wait a minute. Who cares about excuses?
There's a good reason.
What is it, Gary?
I don't know if we're off the Polish thing, but I do have on the line... an incredible Jew hater, a Polish Jew hater.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh. Hmm. Let's put him on with this Letterman guy.
You should.
Now, hold on. You want to hear a guy who hates Jews?
Sure.
Are you Jewish?
No.
Okay, hold on. Here. Everybody there?
Yeah.
Okay. We got a guy from Letterman on and...
You.
And you. You hate Jews.
Okay.
All right, go ahead.
Hi, Howard.
Hi. Well, what's your problem with Jews?
Well, I can tell you if Polish people despise Jews, I can give you a couple of reasons for that.
All right, go ahead.
Well, the primary is they have no loyalty to the country that they gave, gave them home. And it seems to prove in the States, and it proved itself in Poland. The Jews were there for 300 or 400 years ago, and now all they do, they spit at the country that they give home. And if some Polish people killed a couple of Jews, so what? So everybody killed a couple of people for another nation at one point or another. And it seems like this is the only thing you can hold against Polish people. They weren't the Nazis. The Nazis were killing Jews. And if some Polish people kill Jews, then I'm sure some Jews at another point, another place, killed some Polish people. So what?
No, it's all even.
Yeah, okay. All right. Well, thanks for your call. I'm not going to argue with you. I mean, you want me to refute what he just said?
I'd like to ask you one thing. I mean, you tell me, how are the Jews different from the Arabs? Because for me, they are the same. They both have this medieval religion. They're both dirty. If you go to a Jewish home, you can smell it from outside.
Oh, boy.
There's never going to be any peace in the world. But at least,
you want to know, I mean, an honest opinion, why people, they don't hate Jews, they have nothing against them, but they despise them for the reasons I gave you.
Hey, ask Dave if he wants you to bring this guy on with me. What do you think?
Yeah, I tend to think there'll be a problem with that.
Yeah, I would think so, too.
Yeah, I don't know. I think it'd be good entertainment.
I might just be too honest for the air, you know?
Not for this air. We put anybody on. Wow, you're filled with anger.
Actually, you got me excited when you said that actually what you have against Polish people is because they are killing Jews.
I don't have anything against Polish people. I said Poles don't like Jews, and Jews don't like Poles.
No.
So obviously I was right.
You said that Polish people go around killing Jews.
Polish people in World War II killed Jews. So that's why the Jews don't like them. So what are you going to argue with me?
Well, I mean, you are cutting exactly the opinion of the people that came from Poland, the Jews that came from Poland. Now,
what? Wait a second. You think that people...
The country gave them home, right? The country gave them home for a couple of hundred years.
Yeah.
And then the Germans came, they killed the Jews on Polish soil, and now the Jews are blaming Polish people for that?
Listen to me. The Jews don't like Poles, and the Poles don't like Jews. I made that statement.
Right.
So I said, call up if you don't like Jews, if you're Polish.
Exactly.
So you called up. So there it is. What are you arguing with me for?
Well,
you're proving my point right.
I'm just, okay, but not for the reason. I mean, nobody was...
Not for the reason?
There was no
reason. I didn't tell you to say there was a reason.
Exactly.
No, this all started because Lech Walesa is apologizing
to Israel.
He didn't do anything. What's he apologizing for?
What is he apologizing for?
He is the head of state. He has to say what he has to say. I'm telling you how people feel.
I see.
If people don't like Jews, it's because they are different and they don't want to assimilate with the Polish population.
And how well are you assimilating? Listen to your accent. How long have you been in this country?
12 years.
Maybe it's time to drop that thing, huh?
As a matter of fact, I'm going back.
You're going back to Poland?
Exactly.
Really?
There's no more reason for me not to go back. The country is free and I'm going back.
It's a shame to lose you.
Well, I'm sick and tired of the Polish jokes because I didn't deserve them.
Right. Okay. All right, I gotta go. I'm in the middle of a pre-interview for Letterman. I'm in the middle of doing my Letterman thing, okay?
Okay.
All right, man.
Take care. Okay. Bye.
What am I gonna do? Reason with that guy? We'll be back right after these words.
Nothing but the greatest hits, and that's what it is. You're listening to the best of Howard Stern on the Classic Rock Station 92.3, and it's me, David Lee. David Lee Roth, getting off right here on 92.3 K-Rock.
And his in-laws on the best of Stern.
Well, good morning. And what a weekend it was.
How was your weekend?
Very interesting.
Did you have your boys' night out? I thought about you.
Yeah, I did. It wasn't that good.
Really?
Yeah, it got all messed up. Well, you know, it's kind of weird. My in-laws have been living with me now. Now I forget what my wife's even like. I was yelling at my wife on the phone last night. I just said, I can't wait for you to get home because my wife left me for 2 weeks, so we're about a week into it.
Yes.
And I swear it's been the longest week of my life. Oh, Robin, you don't know. It's been the worst.
What is it?
You know me, I like things with my wife. I like the way my wife does things.
Right.
I don't want
to... You're used to that.
I didn't get married to live with my mother, and I didn't get married to live with my mother-in-law and my father-in-law.
You definitely didn't get married to live with your mother-in-law.
You bet.
My mother-in-law is something else, boy. She's great with those kids. Hey, let me preface it. Let me preface this whole discussion.
Yeah, say something good.
And we
got
to
say something good.
And let's get this discussion off our chest early in the morning so that
they can sleep through.
So that, yeah, right, because they're asleep now.
Oh, you.
But I'm slowly losing my mind. What a weekend. I know I'm depressed because all I do is sleep. So, it's just, you know, I have my way of doing things and stuff. And I wake up in the morning and, you know, God bless my father-in-law, who I love dearly. But, you know, I just put in a new couch. You know what I mean? It's like, you know how you're having your cat's claws taken out so your couch won't get messed up?
Yes.
I just put in a new couch.
And you can't cut off his feet.
I can't cut his claws off, but he has his dirty, smelly feet up on my couch. And he insists on taking every newspaper in the house and piling it on the couch.
Why is it
and
that
I walk
this has
by,
been going on for years?
I keep telling him. And, you know, it's like embarrassing, though, because you don't want to be, like, I started feeling guilty. I said, gee, aren't my in-laws really nice to come up and take care of the
that
kids and stuff
very nice
while my
place.
Wife isn't here? And then I said, wait a second. Why am I so complimentary for them helping? My wife should be home.
There shouldn't even be a need.
Right. In other words, I'm sitting there kissing their ass because they came and helped me, but they're helping me because my wife left me.
It wasn't like she was sick or
right.
anything like that. She just voluntarily left.
She wasn't in the hospital. If she was in the hospital, that's one thing.
She abandoned you.
For 2 weeks. Oh, man.
So you sort of started thinking they shouldn't even be here.
And my wife, when she calls, she's so happy on the phone. It's like, I feel really good, and this is the greatest thing. It's so good. And I'm like, you know what? She's going to leave me.
Why do you say that?
She's having too much fun on her own.
Oh, no.
She's going to stick me with the kids. She's going to be one of those mothers that runs off or something.
She's a runaway mom. Somebody
yeah.
put her face on a milk carton.
So she better get her ass home.
Before she finds out what the good life is all about.
Yeah, and I just said, hey, wait till you get home. I got a treat in store for you. She goes, what? I go, I'm leaving you. I'm leaving for 2 weeks. No, you can't do that. I go, wait till you see. I already called the travel agent.
Well, this is nice to come
yep.
home to.
I called the travel agent. I'm going away for 2 weeks.
Where are you going?
I have a place picked out. No, I can't tell you where it is because you'll tell her.
You're not going.
I'll just call her from there.
First
oh, yeah?
Of all, he
oh, yeah?
Fly.
How much you want to bet?
It must
oh,
be
I'm not
place
flying.
You can drive
yes,
to.
It is a place I'll drive to.
And you can drive there by yourself?
4-hour drive. I used to drive it all the time. I've been there before.
I don't believe this.
It's my old girlfriend's apartment.
Oh, stop it.
It's still there waiting for me.
She's not in it.
No. I know where it is exactly. I know exactly how to. Well, I mean, you know, I kind of know how to get to it. I'll call AAA. I'm going to rent a nice big one of those party vans.
How are you going? You can't do it. You can't
and I'm
drive
going
anywhere
with,
by
I'm also
yourself.
Going with two other guys.
Yeah.
Until she sees. I'm going to be gone for 2 weeks.
Oh.
See how she likes
you're
it.
You're not doing this.
Yeah. No, I'd like to.
You're threatening.
I want to do it. Because, oh, man, my in-laws. I woke up Sunday morning to a list of questions. You know what they do when they... My mother-in-law is not even interested. She is not interested in anything I have to say. She wants to be with the kids, and she'll even ask me a question and immediately start muttering while I'm talking to her.
Yeah, you get the first couple words out, and then she's on to another subject.
I'm sitting at the kitchen table talking to my father-in-law about tennis, because that's his passion in life. And I'm asking him about McEnroe or something like that, and then all of a sudden, I hear my mother-in-law in the corner, what about, what's the one that ran away to Trump's...
Oh, Monica
what
Sellers.
About Monica? What about... She didn't call her Monica Sellers. Calls her Monica. What about Monica? 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 That's how she just says it. And my father-in-law goes, finally pays attention. She just keeps saying it over and over until someone pays attention. Then my father-in-law goes, well, you mean Monica Sellers. And then he starts answering about Monica Sellers, and she starts talking. It's like a madhouse in there. But whenever I walk into the kitchen, it's time to start asking me questions. Now, I'm going to describe something to you at my house that's going on. I'm living with my in-laws, okay, in case you're just tuning in. You got to check this out. And they're great people. Robin, please, let me say this. I love them. My kids love them. Everybody loves them. But you know how, you know me. Everybody gets on my nerves, all right? So nobody can be perfect in my eyes.
Sure.
You know, it's like my sister walked in last night just for 5 minutes. Oh, you must be lonely. And I go, get out of here. Just get out of here. Get out of my house. Just because you came out of the same room, get out of my house.
Oh,
you must be lonely. It must be so hard.
Ooh.
And it's just like, what are you talking about? There's nothing hard here. I'm not doing anything different. My in-laws are upstairs. God, I hate. I'm like, out of my mind. I'm a man on fire.
But it's true. It's just a thing of when anybody strange is in your home, you know it.
My head's going to explode from it. last night, I decide, okay, as a treat, I'll go out and buy Italian food because the kids love ziti and spaghetti.
Yeah.
So I went out and got, Italian food. And I said to my in-laws, I said, I'm going to go out and buy us a big trough of ziti with eggplant. Everybody like that? You know, I said to my mother-in-law, you like that? My father-in-law, you like that? Yeah, okay. So I buy a little, I buy a child's portion for my kids. One of ziti and one of spaghetti. Deborah likes spaghetti. Emily likes ziti.
Uh-huh.
Okay? I go. I pick up the stuff and everything. I come in. I dish out for the kids spaghetti. And I know Deborah can finish off a man-sized portion of spaghetti.
Uh-huh.
And I give Emily her ziti. And I said to my father-in-law, here's the ziti and eggplant that I bought for us. Turns out my mother-in-law doesn't eat spaghetti now. Now I find out. I didn't know this. I said, why don't you tell me? So she's not eating any of it. I spent all this money on this food. She's not eating any of it. Then I catch my father-in-law eating the kids' spaghetti. I go, Bob, what are you eating this spaghetti for? That's for the kids. He goes, feeling like things might be under control. So as soon as I walk in the kitchen, it was like a barrage of questions about radio and TV.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, this is within a minute and a half.
This list of questions.
I wrote them all down.
Was fired at you.
Hey, ready?
All right.
I wake up Saturday morning. I walk in the kitchen. I'm dragging my ass because I was out late Friday night. Ready?
Okay.
All right. My father-in-law goes, Howie, I can't get the cable working in my room. I have a TV in their room.
Okay.
I can't get... Do you have a wire that connects the TVs to the VCR, about a 3-inch cable wire with the bomb? Why don't you just, like, I put a different TV in there so you can watch tapes. Everything's all set up for you. What's the problem? There's no problem there. Howie, when did Kitty Carlisle Hart... I showed him the TV show that we have coming up in July.
Right.
When did Kitty Carlisle Hart add the Hart to her name? They know I met Kitty Carlisle Hart.
So now you know her.
Now I know
history.
I go, Bob, how would I know when she... I mean, I just had her on the show for 15 minutes. How would I know when she did that? That's how I answer, right? Then, boom, the next question comes. How much is a person like Arlene Francis or Kitty Carlisle Hart or Dr. Ruth paid when they come on your show? I go, and Bob and Norma, both my parents, my in-laws are there in the kitchen.
Yeah.
So when one starts in, the other one starts in. And they know I'm totally aggravated. They know I'm, because I give them one-word answers. One-word answers I give.
Are you sure they know it?
That I'm aggravated?
Yeah.
They've got to know. I'm standing there like seething. I don't want to talk about it.
But then you're saying they like to aggravate you.
Well, I know now how to get back at them, though. Wait, I got it all for you. I know how to shut them up in a second. Wait, you're going to... Wait till you hear my...
This is a thing of beauty.
All right, right. Now, wait a second. We got to take a break.
Uh-oh.
Because someone special is calling in about 3 minutes that you're going to be interested to hear from.
Oh, yeah?
Freddie, take a break, and then I'll continue this.
We're still in the list of questions.
Yeah. Oh, you got to hear it. It's about 20 questions.
While you're still waking up.
Yeah. The second I walk into the kitchen, and none of them are interested in the answers. My mother-in-law talks right through the answers. I'll be back right after these words.
Hi, everybody. This is Huey Lewis, and you may not believe it, but you're listening to the best of Stern on 92.3 K-Rock.
It's just weird. Exactly. Because, like, last night I had to run out and get dinner. Usually my wife would do that. And I'd say, hey, to your parents, you go do it. So it's me and my in-laws living together.
You sound like another person we know.
So it's just like, yeah, right. And it's just, like, kind of weird because I said to myself, boy, they're really good people. They come here. My wife went away for 2 weeks. I'm really appreciative. I go, wait a second. What am I being appreciative for? My wife's the one who should be appreciative. I didn't want my wife to go in the first place. I didn't want her to leave me for 2 weeks so I could live with my in-laws.
You really didn't? You didn't tell her it was okay for her to go?
She, this is what she did, and I swear to God this is the truth, Robin, okay. As hard as it is for you to believe.
Because I can't believe that she didn't,
my
like,
wife
check
didn't,
this out with you.
She didn't tell me she was leaving. She didn't tell me, and she waited till about 2 weeks before she was leaving to say that she was going to go, and she had arranged the whole thing that her parents were going to come and help with the kids and stuff. And I said, wait a second, you kept this a secret from me for how long? Oh, a few months. I said, now listen, this is not right. She goes, well, because I knew you'd bitch and moan, and what's, I go, listen, you're getting out of hand. I don't mind you going away, but take everyone with you.
She should have made sure the children were out of the house, everything.
I said, let me get this straight, Allison. So in other words, I'm going to have the kids, and I'm going to have my mother living with me. Something that I left the house at 7 to 18 years old and never returned. You're telling me I got to live with my mother? Oh, no, just for 3 days. And then you live with my parents. Your parents?
Something you never wanted to do.
Right. Because, you know, my parents have so, my in-laws have so many questions. So many questions. Saturday morning, I wake up groggy, okay? I come downstairs, and I'm out of my mind groggy. And boom, 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 boom. Because my mother-in-law goes, oh, Howie, we haven't talked to you yet. Now, I know, she always says that. The whole time she's there, she always goes, oh, Howie, we haven't talked to you yet.
We haven't had our chance to talk.
We haven't had our chance to visit.
That's right, to visit.
To visit.
Oh, we must visit.
And like every once in a while, all she'll ever do to interact with me is go, how are you, darling? All right? All right, darling?
She hasn't patted your head yet.
She patted my arms.
Oh.
But my father-in-law is the guy who like walks around the house asking questions.
He follows you.
And then my mother-in-law hears, and she feels like she should be like listening. So she'll start chiming in with things across the room and go, what? So here is with a list of questions they asked me literally within a minute.
Okay. On a
Saturday morning. I walked downstairs. First they asked me about the cable antenna television. All right? I had to go through the remotes, the clickers, and my father-in-law needed wire. He needed 3-foot wire for the cable. Because the TV set didn't reach the cable outlet. He wanted to know if I had a connector. Okay? That was number one. I said, how would I have these things? I don't have it.
But why did you put a TV in there that wasn't hooked up?
He wanted to move the TV.
Oh.
And it didn't move far enough. Number one. They knew that I had Kitty Carlisle and Arlene Francis on the TV show that we're doing in July. My father-in-law says to me, when did Kitty Carlisle Hart change her name from Kitty Carlisle to Kitty Carlisle Hart? That's when I just said, Bob, how would I know that? I'm not friends. Just because she comes on the TV show doesn't mean I'm friends with her. I don't know when she did that. How would I know that? Doesn't that seem like kind of a... Now, they after I give an answer like that, they should sort of pick up that I don't want to talk about my life. I want to talk about their life. I want to talk about my kids. I don't want to talk about my TV and radio career. And quite frankly, who gives a fat rat's ass when Kitty Carlisle changed to Kitty Carlisle Hart? Then he says, how much does the TV show have to pay an Arlene Francis or a Kitty Carlisle Hart or a Dr. Ruth or a Bob Hope to come on?
You know what? It's almost like they're the audience in a Donahue show, and you're the guest.
No, you know what it's like? You know how our listeners call up with questions?
Yeah.
That's what my in-laws are like. They're like one of the listeners.
But have you ever seen Donahue when he has those celebrities on?
Yeah.
People call up and they ask questions, or stand up and ask the most incredible questions.
So I start giving one-word answers. I go, and I don't even put in, like, certain words. I go, like, this is the answer. Okay, so how much do they pay Bob Hope, Arlene Francis? I go, pay? Nothing. It's for promotion. Pay nothing for promotion. Okay, so it's, you know, and I act real dizzy when they ask me these questions. I go, what? And I make them repeat the question, like, 2 or 3 times, hoping that they'll get annoyed.
Uh-huh.
But they don't. They just barrel on.
They don't seem to notice.
All right. Then it was our producer, Dan. The TV show was over Saturday because we were doing some editing.
Yeah.
Dan, what does he do for you? What are his duties? I said, he's a producer. He's a producer? I thought you fired the producer. I said, I didn't fire the producer. The executive producer resigned. Oh. But what does Dan do? Well, he does a lot of stuff because we only have one guy. We're down to 2 people working on the TV show. What does he do? Well, he does a lot of the you get the frustration. I mean, how would you answer what Dan does? He produces.
Everything.
Okay. My father-in-law said, well, he seems, I said, I respect him a lot, he's a good guy. My father-in-law goes, well, he seems like he works very hard for you. I said, right.
We couldn't tell what he was doing.
So my father-in-law then goes, I thought I got rid of them at that point, right? I figured, okay, I've really insufficiently answered their questions to the point where they must know that I'm annoyed, okay?
Yeah.
My father-in-law, it's like rope-a-dope, you know, it's like boom, 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 boom. Then my father-in-law goes, the TV show with Bob Hope, how much promotion will they do around that show? What will they do to promote it? So I go,
where do you think these questions come from?
I don't know, but you've got to understand something. They're rapid fire, Robin. It's like they spent all night thinking them.
How could you even think these questions up?
I don't know.
How are they going? Who cares?
So I answer like this. So let me reenact how I answer. I go, like I have a headache or something. Uh-huh. I go, I suppose they'll just announce it on TV. And I answer that softly. Because any normal human being would reject conversation with me at this point.
Hey, this is family.
We're only like a third of the way through the questions. Then my mother-in-law goes, you must be so excited about Los Angeles. How will they promote that job?
Oh, jeez.
How will they promote your arrival to Los Angeles? I said, they don't. I've asked them not to. What? I'd rather they give the money to us than spend it on promoting. Well, but don't you, won't there be some sort of fanfare? They're from Boston. So I said, like a TV or something? TV or something?
Like a TV or something.
Yeah, right. And then I go, well, you see, what my philosophy is, and then all of a sudden, as I start to answer her, she starts in, kids, what do you want for breakfast? she doesn't even want to know the answer. I know she doesn't want to know the answer.
But these are questions that maybe industry people would ask.
It's just so annoying. It's just like, please, you can see that I'm a stressed out guy anyway. I'm a pretty stressed out individual.
It's the weekend, you're tired.
Let's have some fun.
Want to be with your family?
All right, so then the next question is, my father-in-law goes, Howie, he calls me Howie. It's like waking up with Barbara Walters, you know. It's like, Howie, how much editing will you do around the show I just saw? So then I go, Bob, what do you mean? Well, how much editing does that show need to be prepared to go on the air? I said, well, it's pretty well edited. Maybe one or two more places that have to be tightened up that I didn't like. Oh. Then he says, how do you get guests for your show? And my mother-in-law goes, and yes, does anyone ever call you, darling, and ask, everything's darling. does anyone ever call you, darling, and ask to be on the show? I'm like, what? What? I gotta write all these questions down.
Didn't you think it was kind of dangerous, though, with you showing them a show that hasn't been on the air yet?
You want to know something? I just felt bad for my father-in-law. He was moping around the house, and I was downstairs with Dan working, and I knew he wanted to see it, because that's the show that Allison's on, and, you know, uh-huh. It's like, and I just said, what's the big deal? Let him see it. It's not going to be bad. Well, that was my own fault. I was just, okay, my own stupidity. My own stupidity. He was perfectly willing to stay out of the room.
Ah, I see there.
In a way, I blame myself, okay? So then my father-in-law kept saying, well, how do you get the guests? So at this point, I'm down to one-word answers. I go, Booker, Booker, Booker. So he goes, what do you mean, Booker? I go, we have a Booker. We have a Booker. The guy's name is Frank Smiley. Booker. He books, he calls.
How does he know who to call? And does anyone ever generate their own calls? Will a Kitty Carlisle call you to be...
I said, some people will call to be on the show, others have to be asked. So at this point, I'm like, woozy. Fred's holding up the spot sign, but all right, I'll take a break. I I was woozy, but I finally figured out how to shut them up.
Oh, I can't wait to find out. But was that all of the questions?
Yeah, well, there were more, but I don't even remember. You know.
And you swear to me this couldn't have been.
I swear on my life it happened. It went down within a minute and a half.
Oh, stop.
I timed it. I swear it went down that rapid fire. And I was woozy, but I figured out how to stop them cold in their tracks.
Oh, stay tuned for the solution.
Right after these words.
Hi, I'm Bruce Jenner, and you're listening to the Best of Stern on 92.3 K-Rock, New York's classic rock and roll radio.
On a very busy schedule.
Now listen, I was listening to you all morning.
My mother, everyone.
And
yeah.
I'm
not complaining.
Baby, and only your mother can tell you this.
Ma, look, it was a pain in the ass
listen,
to have my wife leave for 2 weeks.
Let me tell you something, Howard.
The idea
who
that
has people that come in?
I'm not complaining about my wife and my relationship. I'm saying, and I'm not complaining about my in-laws. I appreciate what they're doing, but they're not doing it for me. They're doing it for their daughter.
Yeah, well, they're doing it for you, too.
No.
Let me
explain something to you,
Howard. I mean, who could go out on a Friday night and leave their children and so on and so forth?
What?
Didn't you go out Friday night?
I went out one. You see, I was just in here talking to Gary Wednesday night. He wanted me to go somewhere with him.
Yeah.
You know,
it's
the start
nice.
Of our vacation.
I have no.
I said I don't think I can because my wife now has left. So I'm in. I got a jail sentence too. I can't go out because I'll feel guilty.
2 weeks.
No.
To do
let me tell you something, Mom. When do you ever leave Dad for 2 weeks when we were kids? Never. Ever.
Oh,
ever.
I did if I had to. I
you never had,
I had
to. You never had to.
Oh, absolutely. And listen, you're a.
I'm not complaining.
Baby,
I think I like.
I don't want to hear another.
I'm not a baby. I'm just saying. That, you know, hey, you know, when I'm living with anybody for more than 2 weeks.
Yeah, poor thing.
My in-laws ask a lot of questions. That's
they're
all.
Living with you. You're not living with them.
I'm not complaining about them. You seem to have a problem. I'm just pointing out some of their idiosyncrasies.
Why? Why are you doing that?
Because it's interesting.
It's interesting to who?
To Robin.
To Robin? Robin likes this?
Yeah.
Believe me, Robin would thank her lucky stars if she had somebody to come in and take over. And
I told him I wanted to go where he was. He could have had my apartment this weekend.
Yeah, I would have done
that.
It.
You see that,
yeah,
Robin?
Good.
You're absolutely right. You're a swamp.
I didn't ask for any of this. I have a home and a wife and kids.
You still have the home and the wife and the kids.
No, I don't have the wife.
Will you?
I don't have the wife.
I'm surprised that you have.
No, I'm not surprised at me at all. I'm just saying that I have to act like some kind of martyr
because
I'm living with my in-laws. Every minute with questions about my TV show and my radio
show. They're interested in
you. Well, you know what I'm going to do today? After I hang up with you, we're going to call my in-laws, Robin. I decided.
Yeah.
And they can ask all the questions they want.
Oh, they can ask the questions now.
Right.
Right.
Are you ready to talk?
Right.
I'm ready to talk. That's it, Robin. I'm his time.
No, not you. I'm talking about my in-laws.
You're not talking about me?
No. Are you following me?
I can't hear you.
Why can't you hear me?
What did you just say? You talk so much I can't hear.
No, you're
hear.
Busy talking.
I would like to talk, but you never let me.
Your voice melts my headphones if you talk too long. You're very loud.
Very loud.
Very abrasive.
Oh.
No, listen. What I am saying is.
Yes, let's hear this.
What is? Why are you calling? What is the purpose of your call, by the way?
I feel you're a big baby. That's the purpose.
Okay, well, why do you feel I'm a baby?
Because you're constantly complaining. You're constantly complaining.
About what?
And,
I'm not complaining.
And this time, you have absolutely no right to complain. You should be saying
what?
Very, very nice things. In fact, you shouldn't be saying anything.
No, my wife left me so I can live with her parents. My wife should go live with her parents.
Howard, for
do you
God's
understand my
sake.
Point, Robin?
Listen, your wife...
I know what you're saying, and
my
I know
mother
what
can't
she's
understand.
Saying as well.
No, my mother doesn't understand.
Robin, you know what Allison is doing, and you know how important it is.
Absolutely.
Yeah, she's resting so she can be away from me.
She because sounded very good when I talked to her on the
she
phone.
She sounds great. She's having a great time. That's good.
You'll have a better...
That's all right. I need a rest, too. You should see where I'm going for 2 weeks.
You really do need a rest.
Yeah, I do.
I'll tell you something.
Then I went out Friday night, and it was just so weird. I wanted a man's night out.
Yeah.
And then I felt guilty going because it was like, you know, hey, I'm walking out of the house, but meanwhile, they had everything under control. The kids were asleep.
Yeah. So why did you feel bad?
No, it's just like, you know, if you want to go somewhere, it's like...
He felt bad, but
because I'm living with my mommy and daddy. So,
if you felt bad, you wouldn't have left.
So then it's like, Friday night.
Yeah.
I went over this guy Don's house.
Yeah.
And he's got one of those... They had the fight, the Tyson Ruddock fight.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Well, come on.
My mother's anti-boxing.
But you went to see Thelma and Louise. I couldn't believe that you didn't mind the violence
Thelma
in that.
Thelma and Louise is a fairy tale. And let me tell you something. It gives men a good perspective of themselves, and maybe it will change them. So I like that positive aspect of it.
What is it, John?
Your wife's on the phone.
My wife?
Really? Wow. Now, how'd that happen?
Ma, could you hit that note again? Because my headphones need a little... They got a little...
Howard, I'm going to hang up and you'll speak to your wife. You miss her so much.
No. You could stay on. I'll put you both on.
Oh, good.
Both dueling yentas.
Very nice.
Oh, who's this?
You recognize that voice?
Yeah, that's Jackie's voice.
Hi, Allison.
Hi, Ma.
How you doing?
Good, I'm doing great. Howard, I turned you on. I hear you complaining about me.
Yeah, it's great, Allison. I really enjoy the fact that you leave and I get to live with your parents for 10 minutes.
And I love you so much for letting me do this.
Yeah, well, good. I'm glad because...
Did you really not
me.
Tell him?
No, she didn't. Tell the truth. You didn't tell me you were leaving.
She told you at the right time.
No,
I wanted to make the arrangement so he didn't completely go berserk. I instructed her to do what she did.
Hey, Ma, why didn't you butt out of my life? You know, really.
I know how to handle you, Howard.
Yeah, you know what? You don't. I will resent this.
Howard, you were not in the dark at all.
I was in the dark.
What are you planning? And I said, I'm making arrangements because I wasn't going to do it if it wasn't taken care of.
Wait, don't you have to go rest, Allison, for me?
I'm in the middle
of it. Don't you need a rest? By the way, I'm having a deep rest with your parents. Let me tell you, we're having a real party.
Tell her what you're going to do for 2 weeks.
Oh, I'm going away for 2 weeks. I'm now making plans. I got two guys who want to go away
party,
with me.
Howard. I'm
going away.
The house. I'm not the least bit worried.
Oh, I'm leaving. Oh, wait till you see. You're in for a big shock when you get home.
You're in for a big shock when I get home.
And listen, later on in the show, you might be curious, Allison. I'll be talking to your parents. All the questions they want to ask me, they can ask me on the air. So that's going to be an interesting half hour.
Allison, they ignore him. Voyage party for Howard. If they ignored you, Howard, you'd be so upset.
No, it's not ignoring. It's just let's have some fun. Enough with the radio and TV questions.
Listen,
I don't know why Kitty Carlisle Hart changed her name.
I know that you can't be asked questions.
It's questions that I couldn't possibly know the answer to. They're meaningless questions.
Are you listening to me?
Your father with that VCR, Allison.
They're not meaningless questions. They're conversation.
Did you tell your father not to put newspapers on my new couch? Would you call him up and tell him that?
Newspapers?
He doesn't listen to me.
He did that?
He guys, I'm all over my new couch.
Oh, it's all right. God, what a baby. Right.
If I knew all of the answers to your father's questions, I'd win $64,000.
But don't you understand? You're getting yourself crazy. You're putting pressure on yourself that you have to have the answers. He's just conversing.
No, but I figured out a way to shut your parents up quick.
What is this way you discovered?
Here's what I do. They start in with a list, laundry list of questions about my career that they don't even want to know the answer to. Now, this is what I say to them. Listen to this. You listening, Ma?
Yeah, I'm listening.
I turn to Allison's parents and I go, hey, tell me about your family. Tell me what's going on. I ask them about their family circle. I start asking them personal questions. I ask them personal questions.
Yeah.
Your mother's head explodes. She's like, I don't want to talk about my family right now. She hates talking about her family.
And Howard.
And I get her crazy.
If they weren't there now, you'd be miserable.
No.
That's right.
If they weren't there now, you wouldn't be where you are. Because I take the kids and everybody and ship them right down to where you are.
Well, listen, that's fine. I would love to be with my children.
Yeah, I see how you love it. I see how you love it. I see how everybody loves being with the children, but I'm the only one raising them.
Oh my goodness.
And believe me, you should see how well-behaved everybody is.
I'm ashamed of you, Howard. I'm certainly ashamed.
You are in for big trouble, Mother. I'll tell you why.
2 weeks and be on your own.
No, I'm going to tell you something.
My upbringing of you.
I'm going to tell you something. I'm going to tell you something right now, Ma. You're in big trouble with me. Because you conspired behind my back with my own wife.
That's right, and I'll do it again.
Good.
No, he's making
and you know what?
Point. No one conspired.
Oh, yeah.
Plans and arrangements were made.
Yeah, without my knowledge.
You don't
I wonder
have to
why.
Soft soap him for me.
Don't soft soap anybody.
Him.
I'll get someone to soft soap me right in the shower. Get me a girlfriend.
And I know exactly how to handle it.
Are there any women who'd like to live with me, would like to stay home with a good man? Why don't you give me a call here at the station?
You see why I like Thelma and Louise?
What is your fantasy, Ma? You're going to go around, drive around, kill a bunch of guys?
I don't kill anybody.
Yeah, right.
I don't kill anybody.
All right, I have to hang up. This is
all right, Allison. You go ahead.
Yeah, you're missing all your rest.
Yeah, are you missing your rest? You need to lay down, honey.
You're disturbing her.
Things are a little tough for you right now.
Robin, I'm.
Hey, Rob. Hey, Allison.
What?
Do me a favor. Answer this question. How do we book guests for the TV show?
Oh, Allison, you go about your business. Don't pay attention to these stupid questions.
I just got to really thank him.
Did you miss breakfast, Allison?
Or is it?
I said to him, you know, that at least you're going to make it very inviting for Allison to come back.
Yeah. Gee, Allison, I hope you had your breakfast.
Allison, we miss you and we love you. Go ahead and rest.
All right,
please.
Love you, Ma.
All right.
Rest. You think she's in a mental institution.
Howard, I'm ashamed of you.
Yeah, and rest
you wore her out, Howard.
Yeah, I'm wearing everybody out. Hey, that's no problem. And then my vacation starts.
You are
hold on
a complainer.
Ma, hold on a second. Hold on a second. You still there? Ma?
Yeah, I'm listening.
Oh, gee, I thought maybe I disconnected you.
Yeah, you understand that, right?
So, then my vacation starts on Wednesday.
Yeah, yeah. Where you got plans?
I'm going out and celebrating.
Where are you going?
I'm going somewhere where I am going to
Can
a
I
strip
celebrate
club.
With you?
Oh, you are
not.
Oh, yes, I am.
Answer my question.
What?
What are you celebrating?
My vacation.
Oh, your vacation. All right, so what are we doing?
I'm going to a strip club.
A strip club?
Yeah,
why?
With Gary.
You haven't seen it before.
Wet t-shirt contest.
Wet t-shirt.
What's that club we're going to, Gary?
Like, this could be real.
Oh, this is happening.
Oh, this is happening.
First, I'm going to see Jackie at Rascals, and then I'm going to the strip club.
You got
to
get drunk with Jackie.
I'm going to get loaded.
We're going to the Electric Lady.
Electric Lady I'm going to.
Do you believe it, Gary, that he's going to go to the Electric Lady?
I'm hosting the contest. I asked him if he would come.
And I'm going.
You did?
I want to see those girls. What do you think of that?
Don't count on it.
I'm going to bring my father with me.
Don't count on it, Gary.
You better paint the Electric Lady on his eyelid.
Yeah. Sick
don't
of everybody.
Believe tell you, it, right, Robin?
If
right.
He does come, okay. He'll never come home.
All right.
All right, Ma. It's always a pleasure to hear your voice.
It's a pleasure to hear you acting nicely.
And you know what's great about you, Ma?
What?
When I can't hear your voice over the phone, your voice is ringing in my head constantly.
I did a good job, that means.
Yeah, you didn't do a good job. I hate to tell you, you were a failure at raising me. Because I'm a miserable old man.
A miserable old man.
That's right.
You just get in control of yourself. You know how you tell your guests, calm down?
Yeah.
Just calm down.
You calm down yourself.
Okay, I will.
Very good, very good.
All right, so I'll see you soon, Howard, and we'll make arrangements for the vacation and the big party and everything else.
Yeah, that's what I want to do, spend my vacation with you.
Why? Can you think of a better way?
Yeah. All right, I love you.
All
you know
right,
I
see
do.
See you soon.
I love you, I love you, I love you. All right, very good. There it is. That's my personal help. Welcome to it.
Well, at least your wife calls you on the phone still. She's still in contact with you.
Oh, yeah. She called in for a little radio bit while she's resting. She needs so much rest from me. I'm such an impossibility to live with.
I don't know what you did.
Yeah. Jesus. Have you ever seen me this crazy?
And this is going to be exciting.
And you know I'll get no rest this vacation.
Of course not.
I'll be completely crazy.
I can just see, you've already got your work projects. Forget any ideas of him going away for 2 weeks.
Well, it'll be my pleasure, Robin. Well, I'm not talking to my wife for 2 weeks when she comes back. How do you like that?
He'll pretend he's away to her.
Right. I'll be very distant. When I need some sex, I'll go to her. That's it. And I'll cast her aside like garbage.
But I mean, he'll be kissing her feet. Thank you for coming home. Thank you, thank you. Thank you.
I'm sick of her.
Thank you so much for rescuing me from your parents.
Yeah, and you know what? I'm supposed to be happy because she had her parents come to live with me. Like, oh, gee, they're doing us a favor. Well, yeah, they are doing us a favor, but they're doing her the favor, not me.
Well, she knows, quite frankly, if she had said to you, honey, I'm leaving you with the kids and the housekeeper.
Oh, no, it wouldn't happen. I'd chain her to the refrigerator. She'd never leave.
Which is a perfectly reasonable thing for a wife to be able to say.
I like the way my wife does things. You know what I'm saying? I like the way my wife does them.
I know what you're saying.
Right.
But I'm still saying that she should be able to leave you alone with the kids.
And what should I not retire from my work?
No, you should be able to do both.
Oh, okay.
For a couple of weeks.
No, I am the person who said, if you want to have kids, Allison. Now, remember, I am true to my form. I am not a hypocrite. I said, you want to have kids, you're going to stay home with them. I'm not. I told her that point blank.
What could happen, huh?
I don't care what happens.
Well, if she got sick.
Hey.
If she got sick, that's one thing. And that's not going to happen.
Sick is one thing.
But you still couldn't handle it.
If she's sick, I have to deal with it. And believe me, what I would do is I call my mother and I call my in-laws.
And you'd have your in-laws right there.
But that's when they're doing me a favor. Right now they're doing her a favor.
And you don't like that.
I don't like it. I don't like it.
I think it's very funny that you can't be left alone. You're poor. You're pitiful.
I'm pitiful?
I'm poor. I'm pitiful.
And what are you?
You're a complete mess on your own. No offense.
Oh, you're just
I see
upset.
The way you're going.
You're just upset, and I won't take offense.
Yeah. I see the way you're poor and pitiful. I'm not going to bring it up on the air, though.
What are you talking about?
You don't even know where to live. On your own. I told you 5 years ago where to live. I told you what to do with your cats. I tell you everything what to do. You don't listen. You're another one. Miss Independence.
You know how to run my life.
Yeah.
Can't run your own, but you know how to run mine.
I've got my life perfect, but my wife is there.
Look,
I didn't decide to have children. She did.
You are a father.
I'm a father with a wife. What's that? What is that? That's not your laugh. You're your real laugh.
The laugh can't
that's
get out. It wants to escape so
no,
fast.
No, that's not your real laugh.
Oh.
She has a laugh. When a phony laugh, it goes like this.
It's not phony at all. Not phony at all.
Right,
it is kind of funny that you can't be left alone.
No, I can be left alone. I am not alone. I am in a house.
You are children. You are a father.
No, I am a responsible father. I know what I am capable of. I am capable of going to work and coming home and saying, hey, kids, how you doing? Everything all right? Okay, that's what I am capable of.
Oh, dear.
And I never claim to be anything more than that.
But you gotta admit.
I don't want to be left alone.
But you gotta admit that's kind of funny.
It's not funny. It's not what I bargained for. My wife isn't allowed to leave for 2 weeks.
You could go away for 2 weeks.
Yep.
And she would be fine.
Oh.
She wouldn't have to call in any troops.
Oh, yeah?
She wouldn't have to get anybody there.
That's right, because she doesn't go to work every day. And let me tell you something, sweetheart. If you had two kids, you wouldn't be doing any work either. You'd be a mess. I see how you are with your family. You can't even make a phone call to your parents. Don't even bring up your life.
I'm just saying, you're Mr. Family Man.
Yeah. I'm a family man. And where's my wife? Off by herself. Leaving me with her parents.
Don't even know what to do with your kids.
Don't even know what to do with your kids. No, you don't understand something. Again, I'll try and get through your head. I work for a living. That's my contribution to the household.
Yeah, but you can't, like, pitch in and take up the slack for a few days?
No, 14 days, exactly. No, I can't.
No, they had somebody there.
No, I said I can't.
He left.
I can't. I don't want to know about it. I'm not interested in your opinion.
I didn't have an opinion. I just said it's an interesting thing.
You can't handle yourself for a day. So don't say you're any different.
We're not talking about me.
I've seen you in action.
We're not talking about
me. She's got friends coming to visit her. She's not even letting them stay in the same apartment with her. You're some hostess. The hostess with the mostess. You can't handle people for a few days in your apartment, Robin.
You're asking more people to come in because you can't handle who lives at your house.
I see what you're doing.
Oh,
you can't handle even a guest in your house.
We're not talking about me.
I'm talking about you.
You
want to talk about me? I'm talking about you.
Mr. Family Man.
Well, I see we got a break. We'll be back right after these words.
Just want to remind you to join Jackie the Joke Man and many others for Sand Aid, a benefit show and auction at the Crescent Beach Club in Bayville, Long Island, Friday night, January 15th, with all money going to flood victims.
Family, and I never got that opportunity, and I wish I had because, you know, it's so hard to live a double life, and living one life in this world is hard enough.
Here's Ted Williams. I got it. I was just killing time.
Yeah, because Dave is droning on, as usual.
Yeah.
Hi, Ted. I'm here from the Howard Stern Show on 92.3 K-Rock. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Congratulations on your illustrious career.
Yeah, thank you.
And could I ask you, do you think, we wake up every morning and thank God that you don't play for George Steinbrenner?
No, not a bit. I think he's done a lot of good things for this game. You know, when a guy's down, they can criticize all they like. He's been quite a color.
We're just warming him up for the big question.
Yeah.
Right.
Just
don't get nervous.
Sit tight.
Yeah.
Cool guy in this game. You can, like I say, you can find some things to criticize about anybody, but I don't. I certainly am not one guy to criticize.
You know all the words to the national anthem?
No, I wish I did be able. I don't sing.
By any chance, did you ever accidentally fart in the catcher's face?
Pardon?
By any chance, did you ever accidentally fart in the catcher's face?
Who the hell are you? That kind of damn stuff. See you later.
Okay.
Mr. Cole, you know, I'm here at the baseball card convention. How was that?
Oh, he was just ejected.
Get the hell out of here. I don't take any of this damn crap.
Who the hell are you?
How do you like that?
That was beautiful.
So you have a sense of humor. Because you're a young guy.
Yeah, but he's not at one of those baseball conventions yet.
Yeah, that's true.
That could make you crazy.
Can't say this.
No. Steve just wrote me a dirty joke to say about Dave Pallone.
Oh, that's not nice.
I'm not reading it. You read it.
No.
What was it?
Because it's too dirty.
Have you heard the one on Tom Lasorda?
What's that?
The one where he goes out to the pitcher's mound. He's taking Doug Rowe out of the game.
Yeah.
In the playoffs or in the World Series in 77.
Right.
Oh, this is, you should get this tape. It's already beeped out several times, so you wouldn't have to have it censored. You could play it on the air.
Oh, yeah?
Gary does that.
Well, Gary played that for me. The one where he's cursing like every other word? Mm-hmm. Tommy Lasorda?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's a great tape.
Yeah?
Have you ever heard it?
No.
It's really...
Hey, Gary, bring that in. Robin never heard it.
It's almost like one constant bleep, like...
Yeah.
You bleep.
Tommy Lasorda just freaking out. Is that Tommy Lasorda?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That is him. He lets them out of that balloon, I think.
You got that tape?
We have it on card. Ernie thinks he knows where it is.
Oh, good.
Because there's another really good one... The manager of the Cubs.
Keep Steve talking, because every time he stops talking,
he
makes that fart.
Yeah, I know. He's so into it. You can't believe he's on radio and he can fart.
What?
I mean, you're just like out of your mind with this power
you
have.
The only time Steve is not making the fart noise is when he's talking.
Right.
Okay?
Why do I get blamed for this?
Why am I
getting blamed for this noise? I mean,
see, I'm talking. Did I do that noise? I mean, what's Ernie doing with our Tommy Lasorda tape?
It's not ours. It's on a record.
Oh.
It's on a record.
Yeah,
I didn't know.
Rhino Record puts out a...
Hey, come on, let's all get out of here. This is...
I can't believe
this has gone on. This has gone on way too much.
I'm just disgusted with you.
All right, Steve. See, he still can't leave.
He's out of his mind.
Give me the plugs.
He's going to have to pay an extra day in the hotel.
What's going on?
Well, I got Sam on the line.
Oh, good.
And I'm about to...
Get Jones?
Jones, so
good.
Are we ready?
All right, yeah.
So you want to prepare Sam?
Yeah, all right. Let me get Sam ready.
You were right about Sam. I'll never tell you again, Howard.
First of all, let me say something about Sam Kinison. Number one.
Hello.
To anybody in show business who doesn't think Sam Kinison can keep an appointment, this is a man who worked last night in a club and now is here bright and early. Now, hey, I don't know what kind of rap people are giving Sam Kinison. How am I doing?
You're doing great.
All right. I don't know what kind of rap people are giving Sam Kinison that he can't show up for shows and stuff, but all I know is every time he's promised to be here, he's been here.
That's right. Well, the basic problem is that I overextended myself.
Right.
I tried to do too much.
You say yes too much.
Sam, I have Joan...
Problem. I said yes too much.
Sam, I have Joan Rivers on the phone.
You do?
Yeah. Did I tell you I'd make that happen?
You said that you would make that happen.
I spoke to Joan 4 o'clock this morning.
My God, what was she doing up?
She's putting the finishing touches on her autobiography, her second autobiography.
Well, that's good.
That's good. Now, Joan is mad at you.
Yeah, I know. I caught that on Current Affair.
Right.
Yes, I saw that.
She was trying to get a key to the room.
I didn't see it, and they're blaming me for giving you bad Chinese food.
Yeah. Well, and they're saying I ate it at 7:30 in the morning.
Right.
Yeah.
All right.
They're forgetting to like add some information, like they moved the call time up 2 hours.
All right, let me get Joan on the phone. Should I get her on?
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't care.
All right. So it's damn chink.
So there are some valid reasons for this, and I would hate to see you two have a permanent falling out.
Right. Joan?
Yeah, listen, I'm on. Who's paying for this?
I'm paying for it.
Then I'm on.
All right, Joan, on the other line is Sam.
Yeah, I heard.
All right, now let me set this up. Sam did my show.
Tell me.
All right, and then we're supposed to...
a raunchy radio show, as they said.
Right, a raunchy radio show.
Then we know it was yours.
Then it was mine. There is no other raunchy radio show.
An allegedly raunchy radio show.
Yeah, I didn't think it was raunchy at all. Did you, Sam?
I just think so. As a matter of fact, if I remember correctly, people were writing them in fact, and Sam.
How do we know this is Sam?
One of the best shows you've ever had.
Believe me, that's Sam.
How do we know this is Sam?
Joan, clear your throat.
See, I sang Love Me. to you in Las Vegas.
I love you, Sam. Let me tell you something. I was so angry at you. Watch my show today.
I haven't been this loved since my second wife.
No.
John Marvin Mitchell.
Excuse me. Sam, I kept an audience for 2.5 hours. They kept telling us on the telephone, he's on his way over. 2.5 hours, I stood and talked to an audience waiting for you. Why didn't they just say he's not coming?
You guys moved up the call time, and I was not informed of this.
We didn't move up the call time. We always stay with that.
It was not 12:45. I was told it was 2:45. I thought I had several hours to recover from Howard's show.
But at 2:45, we were still waiting for you.
Well, yeah, but I mean, that was not enough time. I overextended myself and tried to do too much.
Let me just say, I'm not mad at you.
I apologize for the inconvenience to you.
You don't have to apologize.
Because I love you. I've always loved you. I've defended you to people. I've said, I think you're the only true comedian.
I don't respect anyone in stand-up comedy.
I've always said that.
What are you angry at? You're angry at me.
I'm not angry at you. I'm angry at the press that I'm getting. I'm angry about the phone calls from everybody in the industry that I got yesterday. How they're going to yank me from the Emmys. They're yanking me from everything.
Why should they yank you from
everything?
That's not my fault. The current affair piece that was put together by your people, obviously. Not by my people.
Well, where did they get the footage from your show?
Who the hell? Sam, let me tell you something.
Where did they get the footage from your show?
What are you talking about? Where did the footage from your show?
Sam, it didn't have anything to do with that.
Sam, what you don't... Now, wait a second, Sam. Hold it. Don't blame me. Your people told me you were on the way. Let me finish. On the way.
As an alcoholic, it's out of control.
Howard, can I please talk here?
Yes. No, can I say something, though?
Can we talk?
Can I just tell you guys
can
one?
Can I just start? No, give me a chance.
Watch my show today.
We talk about it. We waited for 2.5 hours. I stood in front of an audience for 2.5 hours that came to see you, Sam, and said he's coming. People on the phone said he's on his way. He's on his way. Your people, not my people, your people said he's on his way. He's on his way. He's in the limo. He's on his way. He's on his way. It doesn't take 2.5 hours to get from the plaza. I figured that out to 57th Street in New York. What am I supposed to do with 300 people that are sitting there waiting for you? We had a show to do. We had a crew there. So we sat down and we interviewed my staff. One of them played you because she had interviewed you, so she didn't watch it. She does most of the questions. She does all your answers. I think, Sam, you are the smartest and the most brilliant, and you say what I think on stage. I've said that all over. I just finished putting that in my book, I swear to God. So don't yell at me what happened. Tell your staff they should tell the truth. Say he's sick.
I talked to Howard yesterday. So I would love to talk to Joan and work this out.
I was going to call you to
pay the expenses that you're out for me coming up there. I'll be glad to come back and do it every time, and I'll pay myself.
I wouldn't do anything.
I'll pay myself. I'll pay my own way to come back and make this up to you. I love you.
September 10th, you got a date.
I think you're the best. I'll do anything I can to make this work.
Don't be mad at me because we're just coming up with the National Enquirer. Don't be mad at whoever said he's coming.
I just woke up yesterday, and I got hit with, I don't want to go over on the air because it's...
Well, then you should yell at...
show business, but...
Well, then they're stupid, and they're wrong, and they shouldn't do that to you.
Well, one of the networks is the people you had trouble with at one time, so...
Tell me.
Yeah.
But you know that A, it's going to pass. B, you know that's not going to stay that way.
Okay.
And C...
Are we still in love?
Beyond love.
Okay, good.
Well, you know, in all fairness, when I called Joan this morning, she says, you know, I really love Sam.
Yeah, I really love her.
And, you know, also, in regard to Current Affair, I must tell you that I was recently the victim of them, where they got
not
a hold of...
you.
Yes. I was recently the victim where they took two of my television shows and played them on the air without permission.
Oh, is that how they do that?
And let me tell you something. They took my show and... they asked for no permission. When I called them up and asked them how they got it, they told me somebody gave it to them. I know who gave it to them. And as a matter of fact, they said... Richard Simmons. No, it wasn't Richard Simmons.
Richard Simmons. That's what he does. He exercises and he gives
coverage. Richard Simmons gave it to him.
Now, Sam, we got to get this straight here. Now we don't want you being the victim of jealous industry types who want to keep you off...
Well, now we're on in L.A. This message will go out to L.A.
This message will go out to L.A.
Just be listening to L.A. for sure.
I have patched things up, and I will come back. I promise, Joan. I will not do Howard's show.
Joan,
I'll do Howard's show the next day after your show.
All right, Sam, listen to me very carefully.
I will do it exclusively with you. No Letterman, no Howard, no nothing.
It was kind of a weird day, too, because...
Well, it was just too much. I allowed too much to be piled on myself. I overextended myself, and nothing got done.
Now, what happened with Letterman, though?
It was a case of trying to do too much.
What happened with Letterman?
He didn't do Letterman because I was waiting with a camera crew. I said, if he's doing Letterman...
Well, it wouldn't have been fair to not do you and then do Letterman. That
exactly right. And I was waiting. I said, if he's doing Letterman, I'm going too.
No,
which would have been something because I'm not allowed on Letterman's show.
You're not allowed on?
No, I
didn't know that.
Is that because of Johnny Carson?
What do you think?
Oh,
yeah. Let me tell you something. I was talking about this yesterday, Joan. I don't know if you heard it.
I listen to you all the time, Howard, even when you're not on.
This Johnny Carson is such a creep. Sam, I have to say this.
Hey, Joan and I talked about it one time on her show. We did the show in Vegas.
This guy thinks...
about how Jim McCauley...
This guy thinks he...
...took me around for 6 auditions, and then it took me 10 years to do that show, and, you know...
I have always resented this thing, you gotta go ask Johnny. Like, yeah. This Johnny is the Pope of show business. I'll tell you one thing, I'd rather not be in any kind of career than have to go kiss Johnny's ass and ask him permission, I want to go do a show for Fox Television. What kind of crap is... I had a very nice relationship with Joan, and she did not come to me and ask my permission.
My contract was up.
Well, yeah, excuse me. My contract's up, and
yeah,
I didn't know I'm not allowed to
have a
job
offer.
Hello,
Robin. You were brilliant on my show.
Why, thank you.
Well, Robin made it.
Robin's got somebody.
Oh, yeah.
Sam, did you see her body?
Yeah,
you were there.
I thought that guy you set her up with, though, was a little bit old.
Oh, you stop it.
At least he was straight.
He was breathing.
Yeah, he was straight. That's true.
He was straight?
But,
she should fall on her knees for that one and say thank you.
Oh, I know that the day...
Probably did. My mom yesterday.
What was that?
My mom called me.
Yeah.
And Joan's met my mom.
I like...
And
Sam...
She was like, how did you do this to Joan? She went off on me worse than anybody.
Sam, listen
to me. My own mother was livid.
I know for a fact Sam ate bad Chinese food and got sick.
Hey, walk one.
So why didn't they just say that, Sam, at 12:45?
Walk one, 4th and 1st. I went from Howard Show to eat there at walk one. And I'm not saying that they have bad food there. That's
right.
One of my favorite little restaurants.
It just didn't agree with you that day.
I was totally bushed and you know, I did 2 shows the night before.
Right.
And I
don't apologize,
Sam. I was under the impression we were doing the show around 2:45.
You were saying it was good Chinese food. It's just that for some reason, maybe you had a virus or something.
No, it wasn't that. Here's what happened. So I laid down for 15 minutes, and my brother comes in and says, we got to go do the Joan show. And when you've been up that long, you get 15 minutes sleep. You're
Sam,
like, what?
Listen
what are you
to
talking
me.
About?
Don't.
We had a couple hours. He goes, no, the last
Sam.
I go, what? I can't do it. I'm a mess. I got time to clean up.
Well,
right,
you know,
now, but does Sam hear
the
date?
And then they kept going back and forth or whatever, and I was kept out of it. And, again, I'm taking total blame for this. I'm not trying to dust anyone. I overextended myself.
And well, they're all going to come around.
I know what was
if the
weird.
The Emmys doesn't use you, then you should get everybody.
Like, my career depends on if I get on the Emmys.
Wait a second.
I'm just saying that it just, you know, I don't care about the rest of this.
Have everybody call up and tell them they want you on the Emmys.
Because I think you're one of the best, and I've always respected you.
Sam, you were booked to be on the Emmys? You were booked to be on the Emmys, and they called you?
That's what I'm told. I'm told I was yanked from
the Emmys. Well, who would call and yank you from the Emmys?
I have no idea. They won't give me a name, because I want to call them up and ask the same question.
What kind of thing is that? Why would they do that? Why would they do that?
The thing that came out in USA Today was that I'm an alcoholic and I'm out of control and
so what if you're out of control? That's why people like you.
Well, no, yeah, great.
No, I'm saying. Who wants an in control Sam Kinison? I'm not looking for that.
Well, you know, I mean, I have made jokes about being part of Family Entertainment, but I'm not going to, like, you know, turn into Captain Kangaroo, you know.
Listen, let me tell you.
That's all we need is another comedic figure with a nasty past.
Sam, you have proven. You have proven today that you are a man of honor. You come on the air. You take full responsibility for your actions.
He's willing to face up to...
But I should have cut the show early, or maybe not even done the show. Did the show the next day.
All right, Sam, listen to me.
I'm sorry, Joe. I really am. I fully apologize.
Over.
Matter of fact, I released a statement saying that.
Well, what happened was, what was kind of weird was...
Did you say my age?
What was kind of weird...
I said I want to apologize to Joan Rivers and the show for any inconvenience.
I went over
to
tape...
I don't want you to say that again. You don't apologize to anybody. You're too smart.
I went over to tape my TV show, and then Joan called me from her TV show to tell me that Sam wasn't on the show, and I... What did I tell you? That Sam basically...
I don't remember what you told me. Watch today.
I told you that you should get... I told you you should get...